Part 6, Commies and Cubans. After a decade of the institutionalized paranoia called McCarthyism, Americans were conditioned to believing in plots and rumors of plots. The unthinkable had, after all, been proved true in the post-war period. Benedict Arnold, Washington's envious fellow general, had not been the USA's first and last traitor. Ethel and Julius Rosenberg really had manipulated their nephew David Greenglass into stealing atomic bomb secrets. Pillar of the establishment Alger Hiss, Secretary General of the conference which established the United Nations Organization, really had abused his position in the State Department by copying papers for the Russian-paid spy Whittaker Chambers to microfilm and hide melodramatically in a hollowed-out pumpkin. And the name of the enemy, the motivating ideology in each and every case, was communism. Reason enough for McCarthy's followers to identify the USSR as a treacherous Machiavellian power. Leninist realpolitik explicitly despised the norms of honor and truthfulness upheld as ideals in traditional international statecraft. But the pendulum swung too far, as McCarthy swaggered and lied to increase his own influence, and his dupes believed every preposterous claim he made, until any sort of internationalist altruism, any sort of concern for the poor, even, heaven help us all, the ability to read difficult books of political theory, was treated with suspicion as probable evidence of so-called un-American attitudes. People who were still overtly of the left and openly declared their respect for the great American democratic socialist tradition of Eugene Debs, Clarence Darrow, and Norman Thomas expected to be attacked. And one such left-leaning American, Sylvia Mager, voiced the suspicion that would make her an instant buff and, as indexer of the Warren Report, a powerful ornament of the buff's community of research. Before Lee Harvey Oswald had even been arrested, she predicted sarcastically, "You'll see, it was a communist who did it." Sylvia Mager was being cynical. Others would voice the same suspicion seriously. And by jingo, Oswald didn't let anybody down. He became the perfect figure to build left and right paranoia alike. A communist or ex-communist who sometimes said he wasn't a communist and declared he was just a patsy before dying and leaving possibly impenetrable mystery. Now, Oswald's personal history certainly invited questions about his loyalty, invited, too, questions about his possible involvement with both the KGB and the CIA, for he had defected to Russia, lived there for a couple of years, married a Russian wife, and then been permitted to leave Russia with her and return to the USA. And he did all this within a year of the death of John Foster Dulles, Halitosic Cold Warrior par excellence, who gave America a foreign policy that quite simply did not allow Americans to go and work for the USSR with the idealistic freedom permitted to car workers leader Walter Reuter in the 1920s. The population of the USA was just under, and the population of the USSR just over, 200 million. And less than 50 of these 400 million people were permitted to move from the one country to the other as private citizens, unattached to trade or diplomatic teams or the news media or the secret agencies, in the period 1959 to 62. Yet Lee Harvey Oswald went casually over and back, picking up Marina as company. No more than 11 Americans, all told, enjoyed the full privilege of taking up permanent residence in the Soviet Union and then dropping it again and returning to America. About 1 in 18 million. Odds enough to lose you a blood test in court and satisfy a jury of your identity. It couldn't be done. But Oswald did it. What's more, he swore that the KGB had never questioned him, never asked him for information based on his service in the Marines. Even unbiased American observers found this incredible. The Warren Report, which took most of Oswald's remarkable history more calmly than most, and subpoenaed Secretary of State Dean Rusk to make valuable observations on the rationale of Soviet policy, gulped a bit as it remarked that Oswald's assertion to U.S. Consul Richard Snyder that he had never been questioned by the Soviet authorities concerning his life in the United States is simply unbelievable. The report would unfortunately fail to observe that paranoia on the left would find it equally unbelievable that all the questioning he underwent in the USA about his life in Russia comprised a few formal interviews with FBI agents. But prima facie, an ex- or maybe not-so-ex-Marxist with an expatriate Russian wife had shot the president. Could he have been trained and planted for this purpose by the KGB? Was Marina a spy sent over with marriage to Oswald as cover? It was bound to occur to people. But Russia was not the only communist state that might have a hostile attitude to President Kennedy. Fidel Castro's Cuba was being treated as enemy number one by the administration. Many Americans had recognized Fulgencio Batista as an undesirable tyrant and welcomed his overthrow by Fidel Castro. But committed free entrepreneurs bitterly resented Castro's takeover of the U.S. fruit company, which maintained a stranglehold on the island's economy. The mafia was furious when the new government closed down their sleazy casinos and kicked them and their frontman George Raft off the island. And anti-Castro Cuban refugees were quite correct in asserting that handsome, heroic Fidel's revolution was positively intended to sweep his nation into the communist camp. Official America's ill-judged attempt at duress through strict economic sanctions and broken diplomatic ties forced Cuba into almost complete dependence on Russia's subsidizing purchase of its sugar crop. So the Eisenhower administration approved the CIA's encouragement of Cuban subversives who wished to invade the island and overthrow the new regime. Unfortunately for Kennedy, he inherited this ill-conceived plot and had to accept responsibility when 15,000 CIA-trained adventurers were completely overwhelmed by Castro's 200,000-strong army. It was the opening disaster of the Kennedy administration, and his fury with both the CIA and Castro was all too obviously a belated defensive recognition of his own poor judgment in letting the wild scheme go ahead. But Castro, too, was stirred by this covert aggression on the part of his mighty neighbour. There were propaganda advantages for him, but in other respects he had to feel unsafe with a man who had once unleashed an army against him in the White House. He was allied to the loser in the eyeball-to-eyeball confrontation by which Kennedy had forced Khrushchev to halt the installation of missiles threatening America on Cuba. Macho right-wing Americans judged that their macho foe must be looking for revenge. Might use the underhand weapon of murder. The State Department was splendidly free from such paranoia. It was, they could see, not in the interests of any established government to introduce deliberate assassination of other heads of government as a new international diplomatic weapon. It was inconceivable to Dean Rusk that either Castro or Khrushchev would perpetrate dangerous folly of that magnitude, and so he informed the Warren Commission to its satisfaction. But by the mid-1970s, there was reason to wonder whether Castro might not have had far better cause to assassinate Kennedy than Rusk dared admit. For in the aftermath of Watergate, the covert activities of the Secret Services came under scrutiny. The great clowns of the Watergate conspiracy were Howard Hunt and Gordon Liddy, who dashed around the country in false wigs, organizing burglaries of President Nixon's supposed enemies and partying memorably in the intervals. Liddy, who sang the Nazis' Horst Wessel anthem to keep his spirits up, had devised an utterly mad plan to run a floating brothel offshore at the Democratic National Convention and secretly film prominent political opponents between the legs of sleazy hookers. And these buffoons, it transpired, were ex-CIA men who retained strong enough ties with the agency to boast of their espionage tradecraft and receive wigs, false identification papers, and pocket litter from the CIA for the perpetration of their antics. The CIA looked almost naive enough to read James Bond for useful tips. and in Kennedy's time it transpired, and with the approval of both John and Robert Kennedy, CIA contacts had conspired with leading mafiosi to assassinate Castro. Some of the methods discussed were so stupid as to make Hunt and Liddy look almost adult. A poisoned cigar. A potion to make Castro's hair and beard fall out, leaving him supposedly unattractive to the admiring throngs who cheered his four-hour harangues. The mafiosi had almost certainly taken the CIA for a ride, listening to their loony proposals and happily chipping in with their own batty suggestions, taking the government's money and doing nothing. All this came out at a time when the martyred president's reputation, too, underwent something of a shake-up. His compulsive sexual activity, discreetly concealed from the public during his life and for many years after, was coming out. He had used the FBI's powers to confiscate telephone records and cover up his and his brother's relations with Marilyn Monroe at the time of her death. So the worst could be believed of Kennedy and the CIA in respect of their anti-Cuban activities, and Lee Harvey Oswald's Cuban connection was ripe for fuller examination. He had actively supported the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, setting himself up as its New Orleans representative and falsely describing an imaginary Alec Hiddell as local chairman. Identifying himself as Alec Hiddell, he had purchased his own guns. The very alias was largely drawn from his communist life and sympathies. Alec was the name his Russian friends and co-workers in Minsk gave him because Lee was difficult for them to pronounce and sounded suspiciously Chinese. Hiddell was the name of another Marine Oswald might have known, but Marina was sure he had adopted it as a jaunty rhyme with Fidel, a disguised assertion of his loyalties. Marina was cynical about her husband's political antics. She herself had been a member of the young communist organization, the Komsomol, until it expelled her for marrying an American. Her membership of that organization seemed suspicious to paranoid ex-McCarthyites, who were accustomed to thinking the word communist a simple synonym for evil. Actually, of course, joining the party in the USSR represented a mixture of ambition for successful public life with uncritical endorsement of official public morality. Inherently, it was no more evil or virtuous than being an American legionnaire and marching on church parades. What such conformist conduct represented to any individual might range from passionate conservative idealism to self-interested acceptance of comfortable support from an unchallengeable public power base. In Marina's case, it seems as likely as not to have been rather unimaginative yielding to pressure to conform that led her into Komsomol. But as far as Lee was concerned, his former young communist wife wasn't the slightest bit impressed with a would-be political thinker who had himself photographed brandishing a rifle and two left-wing newspapers. Marina, by the way, was quite certain that the famous photograph was of Lee and taken by her. The buffs who argue from supposedly impossible shadows that it was faked have been conclusively refuted by microscopic examination of unbroken grain in the emulsion. Despite the serious dangers Lee incurred for himself and his wife by his mad action of taking a pot shot at Major General Walker, Marina exhibited her contempt for her husband by writing on the back of one of the snapshots, "The great hunter of fascists, ha, ha, ha." A joke for her. A pathetically unimpressive figure indeed. But nonetheless dangerous for being such a nerd. Like Guiteau, who killed President Garfield. Like Mark Chapman, who killed John Lennon. Like Carl Weiss, who killed Louisiana's corrupt but charismatic governor Huey Long. Assassinations of prominent public figures in America are normally motivated by political extremism or outright madness with hallucinatory delusions, or else are the work of pathetic failures who appear unable to bear the adulation heaped on their successful contemporaries. That seemed to fit Lee Harvey Oswald as portrayed in the Warren Report. Yet so might extremist political motivation. By normal American standards, he'd pulled the trigger on one man of the right, Walker, and another of the left, Kennedy. But if he was so far off the map to the left as to be a consciously anti-American communist, then Mr. President, whatever his party, might be a suitable target. And Oswald had openly declared himself a Marxist, a socialist, almost everything short of a card-carrying Communist Party member. He said he was dissatisfied with the way the Communist Party dominated the system in the USSR, but that did not mean he rejected its underlying philosophy and principles. He vocally stood up for Castro and Cuba, tried to infiltrate a group of his opponents, and brawled with them when they identified him as a turncoat. He had gone to the Cuban embassy in Mexico City seeking a visa in defiance of the US government's embargo on travel to Cuba. After his arrest, he asked for John Abt as his legal representative, a lawyer he didn't know personally, but who was well known as a dedicated defender of left-wing extremists and a man whose name constantly cropped up in Whittaker Chambers' recollections as part of a communist study group in the 1930s. Didn't everything suggest that Oswald must be a representative of darker left-wing forces than his own muddled mind? An idealistic assassin recruited by the Cuban consulate in Mexico, or primed by the Russians and left in place until he could be used? It might look like that. But as the decade wore on, it came to look even more likely that Oswald was a tool of anti-Castroites. It seemed possible that he was the patsy he claimed, and possibly misled into believing that he was acting patriotically under instructions from government forces. With a second shooter and a fourth bullet apparently guaranteed, attention turned to his dodgy associates in America. The House Committee left David Ferry in the frame, and that led back to Guy Bannister. The anti-Castro conspiracy theory necessarily accepts Delphine Roberts' story that Bannister tolerated Oswald in the office above him at 544 Camp Street. Since Bannister was a fanatic who threw screaming tirades at the least suggestion of left-wing opposition, this suggested that she must be right in remembering Bannister's hints that Oswald was on their side, and the additional claim that Oswald used Bannister's photocopier and worked hand-in-glove with him was a highly acceptable embellishment. By this reasoning, Oswald's grumbles about the Soviet Union were indiscreet revelations of his true anti-communist attitudes. He had joined the Marines as a real US patriot. He had learned Russian with official encouragement. His supposed infiltration of Carlos Bringier's anti-Castro organization was a blind. The brawl on the streets with Bringier, which earned them both a night in the cells, a put-up job to allay any communist doubts about Oswald's sincerity. The exact purpose of Oswald's supposed visit to the Clinton voter registration with Ferry and a possible Bannister was hard to determine. But there were other and better stories linking him with the anti-Castroites. The oddest and most forthright comes from Professor Michael L. Kurtz, who wrote in 1982 without any ifs and buts that Oswald twice visited Louisiana State University in 1963 in Guy Bannister's company, where the two debated racial policy with students and Oswald attacked Kennedy's civil rights policy. And Kurtz believes that he himself saw Oswald and Bannister together in a coffee shop opposite 544 Camp Street, and Oswald waved to him. But perhaps the key to Kurtz's problem, as well as that of Sylvia Odio, who believed that anti-Castro Cubans introduced her to Oswald as Leon Oswald, and convicted anti-Castroite drug dealer Antonio Veciana Blanche, who claimed to have been introduced to Oswald by a CIA man using the pseudonym Morris Bishop, perhaps the key lies in the very ordinariness of Oswald's appearance. He was of average height, average slim build for his age, medium brown hair cut neither hippily long nor militaristically short. His hairline receded in the most obvious position, where he brushed it back at the parting. He was clean-shaven, without spectacles. Thousands of young white men looked roughly like him. Mistaken identity must certainly explain the story of the police lieutenant who believed he saw Oswald emerge from the book depository and get into a car which raced him away 15 minutes after the shooting, at a time when Oswald had definitely embarked on the bus journey, where Mrs. Bledsoe didn't just identify him. As his ex-landlady, she recognized him. Indeed, Oswald's appearance was so undistinctive that several people believed they spotted him among a group of employees photographed standing outside the book depository to watch the motorcade and subsequent commotion. In fact, the young man in the group, Billy Lovelady, positively identified himself. But it is highly significant that Oswald's ordinary appearance could lead to his being mistaken for someone who actually worked in the same one-purpose building for the same small company. No, I don't believe there was an Oswald look-alike being deliberately thrust into view in and around New Orleans as an overture to the assassination. I think the various reports of Oswald's accompanying Cubans and anti-Castroites and Ferry and Bannister in New Orleans during the summer of 1963 can all be put down to the common mistaken identity testimony which inevitably surfaces in highly notorious cases. But we cannot afford to overlook the other aspect of Bannister and Ferry and Vecchiana Blanche. Their alleged link to the CIA could be coupled with the CIA's admitted link with the Mafia.